There is a study that I have been conducting for about 6 months now. I have not been able to finish it because you have to do a whole bunch of things. Plus, it's tough. The study is this. I took 10 years of the first Supreme Court. Technically, that would be 11 years, from 1950 all the way to 1960. And I read through every single reported case on Article 19(1)(f). The fundamental right to engage in trade, occupation, and a profession of your choosing within the restrictions of the law. I'm not going to demonstrate it, but if challenged, I can, that this right, which Cass Sunstein calls an occupational right, a right that is also guaranteed by Article 12 of the German Basic Law, is a part of what is generally understood as economic liberties. It's also understood by several economists to be a part of property rights in the broad sense. So on that, just take my word for it, but I can demonstrate that to be the correct legal position if challenged. The objective of this study is to examine how the Supreme Court has evolved. What exactly was the Supreme Court doing in the first 10 years? The results are very interesting. I'll briefly take you through the results and then I'll offer my comments. I have been able to study 9 years worth of data. So this data is contingent. I have studied from 1950 till 1958, the 2 years worth of cases that I haven't studied so far. There are a total of 35 reported opinions, and that being the keyword, reported in All India Reports. I haven't cross-checked All India Reports with Supreme Court Reports, which is the official report of the Supreme Court, published by the Supreme Court. In All India Reports, you have 35 19(1)(f) cases. 32 of these are 5-judge bench opinions for the professors visiting us from the US. Indian Supreme Court sits in divisions of 2. So you have, if there are 30 judges, you will have 15 division benches or division courts of 2 judges each. But Article 143, if I'm right, of the Constitution says that if there is a question of constitutional importance or there is a question of public importance, which could be a question of common simple law on which all high courts disagree, then a 5-judge bench, which is called a constitution bench, has to be assembled. After that, to overrule a 5-judge bench, there's 7, then there's 9, there's 11. The highest bench that has ever assembled so far has been a 13-judge bench in the famous basic structure case that you might have heard. Out of these 32 cases are 5-judge bench opinions. 2 cases are 6-judge bench opinions, and only 1 7-judge bench opinion till 1958. There are no dissenting opinions. There are absolutely no dissenting opinions till 1958, except in one case, which is again a 7-judge bench case, and the dissent written by Justice Jagannath Das is on the reasoning, not the outcome. He agrees with the outcome of the 5 judges, he just doesn't agree with the reasons that they give, and he goes on to state his own reasons. The judge who decided the most number of cases was Chief Justice S.R. Das. That's as a judge, as an acting chief and a chief justice all combined, he decides a total of, by decide I mean he writes the opinion for the unanimous bench. And when I say he decides in favor of the petitioner, I mean if the petitioners approach the court and they assume that they challenge the validity of 4 provisions in a law, even if 1 provision is struck down as unconstitutional, I take that as a case in the favor of the petitioner. So he decides 4 in the favor of petitioner and 3 in the favor of the state. Surprisingly, Justice N.H. Bhagwati, who's one of the very big foundational pillars, has not decided till 1958 even 1 case in the favor of the petitioner, not 1. Every single case he decides is in the favor of the state. I can keep on adding, there are about 7 or 8 judges who wrote opinions till this point of time. The other judge who absolutely decides nothing in favor of the state, of the petitioner, is Justice Subba Rao. Justice Subba Rao, some of you might recall, is the author of the famous McDowell judgment, which is also a 5-judge bench opinion, which said tax evasion and tax erosion are basically the same things, which judgment, by a process of interpretation, has been practically overruled most recently in the Vodafone case in 2012. Now, what comes out of all this result? One more important bit of data that you might find interesting. The bench comprising Justice Mahajan, either himself or as a Chief Justice, Justice Bijoy Kumar Mukherjee, S.R. Das, Vivian Bose, and Ghulam Hassan. This is the bench that has decided a total of 6 cases, 5 in the favor of petitioner, 1 in the favor of state. The next step in the study, of course, would be to identify the particular idiosyncrasies of the judge in question by examining their off-the-bench writings and also examining the arguments that they made when they were at the bar, and then trying to find a link between whether there was a change in their views or in the alternative, was there a change in their views when they were about to be selected for the chief justiceship. That's the next stage in the study, which I haven't done yet, but I'm expecting some very interesting results. What I have been able to conclude so far affirmatively on the basis of these data are as follows. First of all, these judges don't cite any decisions to support whatever they're saying. At least till 1955, you have not one judgment cited by any of these judges, even though you have previous cases that have been decided. Now, anecdotal evidence suggests quite affirmatively that this is the period of time when the Supreme Court of India wasn't a busy court like it is right now. This is also the period of time when the Supreme Court judges are calling the registrar of the court, and the registrar of the court is calling the counsel of record to please come and do a case in the Supreme Court because they don't have any cases. Nobody's there. This story has been narrated by senior counsel Mr. K.K. Venugopal. His father, Mr. Nambiar, has appeared as counsel for petitioner in many of these cases, and he's on record saying this, that registrar would call Mr. Nambiar in Chennai, in Madras, and then he would say, you please call my advocate on record in Delhi. And he will then get back and then he would go and do a case. So it is not the case that the court was overburdened by any imagination. That's not the case. Also, the court most of these are barristers, right? Most of these have been trained in the British legal tradition. They are certainly very learned people. George Gardboys, in his book, Judges of the Supreme Court of India, which is an extensive study till 1989, if I'm right, has recorded that very carefully. These were sons of Sanskrit scholars, top lawyers. They had education in England. So it is inconceivable, as far as I'm concerned right now, I don't find any reason to justify why they are not citing judgments when lawyers of the caliber of M.C. Setalvad, the first Attorney General, Nambiar, Vishwanath Shastri, these are very, very eminent lawyers who are appearing in the court. It is inconceivable they will not be appearing in the court without a case to cite. So where is that case which was cited? So on the first principles of good decision making, these judgments are all liable to be criticized because they just don't cite authoritative precedents which have laid down the law before. The other problem that I've noticed so far is there is the second Indian case on the point is a 1951 opinion, 51 opinion by the name of Chintaman Rao versus State of Madhya Pradesh, where a legislation was struck down by Chief Justice, Justice Mahajan, then Justice Mahajan, on the ground. And very, very simply, the facts of the case were, the legislation said that the commissioner under the legislation has the authority to issue two notifications. One is a notification that declares any period of a calendar month as an agricultural period. So assume it's a 3-month period that has now been declared an agricultural period. Then he has the power to apply that notification to a geographical area. So you have to have these two notifications. Then in an agricultural area, the law applies, and the law says that during this period of time in the agricultural area, anybody engaged in the manufacture of BDs, for people who don't know, a BD is a country cigarette of sorts, right? We can show you one afterwards, but we wouldn't recommend you to use it. As I'm told by the tobacco people who I have represented in the past, the best BDs that are made in India are all exported. That's true, anyway, because they're more like cigars. Anyway, if you have a factory that manufactures BDs in that area, A, you're not allowed to manufacture any BDs. B, you're not allowed to import any labor to manufacture BDs. C, everybody working in that geographical area is prohibited from working as a laborer in that factory. So those are the two consequences. The BD manufacturers approach the court. They say, first, we don't have any problem with this agricultural area thing. If you want, this is what should be done, then that's fine. But why are you stopping me from bringing labor from outside? I can bring labor from outside. You don't want people of this area to work in my factory, fine. I'll bring labor from outside, but even that isn't allowed, and the Supreme Court agrees. And a unanimous Supreme Court strikes down the legislation saying unconstitutional because it was excessive. That is the word that has been used. Now, the word arbitrary is a word that is thrown around like candy, at least in Indian courts. And I can attest to myself, I'm guilty of that charge, but I was a lawyer, what could I do? Chief Justice Mahajan, then Justice Mahajan, uses the phrase arbitrary, but anybody who can, if you go through the judgment, even if you don't have a law degree, you know he's using the word arbitrary in the sense excessive. This is excessive in the sense, if you want the legislation to make sure that all the labor in that area are available for work in farm fields, very well then, there is no reason to stop other people doing other things. And then he goes on to say that what about people who don't want to work in farm fields? What about people who cannot work in farm fields? What about women, for example? What about people who are not physically capable? They can still go and work and make a living, but by this legislation, you've just shut the door down on everything. And the court, and this is the case where a very clear standard of review is laid down that any legislation, if it is excessive, it will not be allowed, though the standard of review doesn't say what public purpose is going to be. That much is deferred to legislative judgment. Moving on a few years afterwards, this makes sense, this economically makes sense. And if I talk about the particular background of Justice Mahajan, his father was what we would call a baniya. He was a moneylender. That was his family trade. His father was also a mukhtar, and a mukhtar is what we would call a pleader, one who can practice law without actually having a degree of law. They were an inferior class of lawyers back in the day. Now we don't have that class. So his father was predominantly a businessman, a money lender, and having come from that kind of a background, it makes sense also that this judge will go along and say, you know what, this cannot be done. But if we move on a little bit forward, there is a very famous case by the name of Shagir Ahmed versus State of Uttar Pradesh, where there is a bus route, Delhi to Buland Shahar, that's a small town in UP. The bus route is nationalized in the following way. The government comes under Motor Vehicles Act, a license has to be granted for you to be plying a stage carriage on this route. The petitioners have a big fleet of buses, they have invested considerable money, they are in the business for a considerable period of time. So it is not the case they don't know how to do this business. That is the admitted case of the government. We concede they know what they're doing. They will say, a notification is issued. When their license expires, please don't renew their license. These people approach the court. They say, practically what you have done is you've nationalized our business. Because there are two set of notifications. One says don't renew theirs. The second notification says grant a license only to the government state transport corporation. So practically it's only the government doing that business. The Supreme Court comes and says, you are not allowed to monopolize the entire business. And if you wish to monopolize, you have to pay compensation. So this is the first case where hints of a connection between property rights and occupational rights begin to emerge, but this is not the only case. There are other cases also. Supreme Court doesn't apply the principle. It agrees, yes, the right is there, but you know what? Things have to be done for whatever public purpose might mean. Lastly, there is First Amendment that was brought in. First Amendment actually authorizes the government to create a monopoly by putting a clause in Article 19.6. And afterwards, there is a 1957 opinion, G. Nageshwar Rao versus Andhra Pradesh State Transport Corporation, where the case opens by saying there is an investment of 20 lakhs, that would be 2 million if I'm right, of rupees in 1957 and a big fleet of buses. And the exact same thing is done by Andhra Pradesh government. This time it is upheld, and the judges very, if I may use the word for the want of a better term, flippantly come and say, we haven't taken your buses, we haven't taken your share capital, we haven't taken away your license. We are just not going to renew your license. And what of the people who are working for me? And what of the money that I have invested? And what off on a principled ground, forget about the economic senselessness of the judgment, which by the way is not the only one, what off the point that, well, why can you just not stay out, right? I'll conclude by saying one thing, and this is not the only judgment. The judgment after judgment, they keep on making the same mistake. Sardar Patel, at the time of drafting and afterwards till his untimely death, kept on saying, and it's on record, we want to go and monopolize all these industries. We don't even have enough people to run the government properly. How exactly are we going to run these businesses? We don't have any expertise in running these businesses. How are we going to run these businesses? Well, why don't you let the people run the businesses? That's one, which is a critique that we have to start thinking now. The second problem is, I haven't spoken about any of the licensing cases, but at least in one case, Justice Gajendra Gadkar is saying high praises of the virtue of competition in a free market. And in the same case, he says, well, the licensing regime happens to be so, only Tatas are the ones who can obtain a license. If the Tatas are the ones who are the only people who can obtain the license, maybe the government should rethink. Probably it's the Tatas who made the policy to be written that way. That's the other economic problem. You have licensing creates an entry barrier. Now, if the moment I get license, it's in my interest to make sure other people don't get licenses. These are the kind of economic mistakes that the Supreme Court has done. And I believe it's about time we start thinking about it and start correcting the mistakes of history. Thank you.